risen. The Lord is risen indeed. This is the day which the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Dearly beloved brethren, the Scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by His infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together, to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at His hands, to set forth His most worthy praise, to hear His most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and a humble voice, under the throne of Almighty grace, saying together, let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have undone those things which we ought to have done. And we have done those things which we ought not to have done, and there is no help in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou those, O God, who confess their faults. Restore thou those who are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind, in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people being penitent the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all those who truly repent and unfailingly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. O Lord, open thou our lips,
and our mouth shall show forth thy praise.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Praise ye the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
Alleluia, the Lord is risen indeed.
O come with us and adore him.
Alleluia. For the ninth day, from page 9 of the prayer book. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation.
Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and show ourselves glad in him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hand are all the corners of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his and he made it, and his hands prepared the dry land. O come, let us worship and fall down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. O worship the Lord in his holiness, let the Lord stand in awe of him. For he cometh,
For he cometh to judge the earth, and with righteousness to judge the world, and the peoples with his truth. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now,
and ever shall be,
world without end.
Amen.
Whatsoever pleased him.
Their idols are silver and gold,
even the work of men's hands.
They have mouths and speak not.
Eyes have they and see not.
They have ears and hear not.
Noses have they and smell not.
They have hands and handle not.
Feet have they and walk not.
Neither speak they through their throat. They that make them are like unto them.
And so are all such as put their trust in them.
But thou, house of Israel, trust thou in the Lord.
He is their helper and defender.
Ye, house of Aaron, put your trust in the Lord.
He is their helper and defender.
Ye that fear the Lord, put your trust in the Lord.
He is their helper and defender.
The Lord hath been mindful of us, and he shall bless us.
Even he shall bless the house of Israel.
He shall bless the house of Aaron.
He shall bless them that fear the Lord,
both small and great.
The Lord shall increase you more and more,
you and your children.
Ye are the blessed of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
All the whole heavens are the Lord's.
The earth hath given him the children of men.
The dead praise not thee, O Lord.
Neither all they that go down in silence.
But we will praise the Lord.
From this time forth forevermore. Praise the Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Here begins the first verse of the second chapter of the first letter of the prophet Samuel. And Hannah prayed and said, My heart rejoices in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth is enlarged over my enemies, because I rejoice in thy salvation. There is none holy as the Lord, for there is none beside thee. Neither is there any rock like our God. Talk no more so exceedingly proudly. Let not arrogance come out of your mouth. For the Lord is the knowledge, and by him the nations are weighed. The bows of the mighty men are broken, and they that stumbled were girded with strength. They that were full have hired out themselves for bread, and they that were hungry ceased. So that the barren hath borne seven, and she that hath many children is waxed few. The Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and bringeth up. The Lord maketh poor and maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up. He raiseth up the poor out of the dust, and lifteth up the beggar from the dunghill, to set them among princes, and to make them inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he hath set the world upon them. He will keep the feet of his saints, and the wicked shall be silent in the darkness. For by strength shall no man prevail. The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Out of heaven shall thunder upon them. The Lord shall judge the ends of the earth, and he shall give strength unto his king, and exalt the horn of his anointed. Here ends the first lesson.
The 50 day of August is found on page 10 of the book of Common Prayer. Let us recite this canticle together. We praise thee, O God, we acknowledge thee to be the Lord. All the earth doth worship thee, the Father everlasting.
To thee all angels cry aloud, the heavens and all the powers therein.
To thee, cherubim and seraphim continually do cry, Holy, 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 Lord God of Sabaoth. Heaven and earth are full of the majesty of thy glory. The glorious company of the apostles praise thee. The goodly fellowship of the prophets praise thee.
The noble army of martyrs praise thee. The holy church throughout all the world doth acknowledge thee. The Father of infinite majesty,
thine adorable, true, and only Son, also the Lord, the Comforter.
Thou art the King of glory, O Christ. Thou art the everlasting Son of the Father.
When thou lookest upon thee to deliver man, thou didst humble thyself to be born of a virgin. When thou hast overcome the sharpness of death, thou didst open the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Thou sittest at the right hand of God, in the glory of the Father. We believe that thou shalt come to be our judge. We therefore pray thee, of thy servants, whom thou hast redeemed with thy precious blood, make them to be numbered with thy saints in glory everlasting.
O Lord, save thy people and bless their heritage.
Govern them and lift them up forever. Day by day we magnify thee, and we worship thy name for a world without end. Vouchsafe, O Lord, to keep us this day without sin. O Lord, let thy mercy be upon us.
Have mercy upon us.
O Lord, thy mercy be upon us, as our trust is in thee. O Lord, in thee have I trusted. Let me never be confounded.
Here begins the 16th verse of the 16th chapter of the Gospel according to the Apostle John. Jesus said to his disciples, A little while and ye shall not see me, and again a little while and ye shall see me, because I go to the Father. Then said some of his disciples among themselves, What is this that he saith unto us? A little while and ye shall not see me, and again a little while and ye shall see me, and because I go to the Father. They said therefore, What is this that he saith? A little while, we cannot tell what he saith. Now Jesus knew that they were desirous to ask him, and said unto them, Do you inquire among yourselves of that I said, A little while, and you shall not see me, and again a little while, and you shall see me? Verily, verily, I say unto you, that ye shall weep and lament, but the Lord shall rejoice, and ye shall be sorrowful. But your sorrow will be turned into joy. A woman, when she is troubled, hath sorrow, because her hour is come. But as soon as she is delivered of the child, she remembereth no more the anguish, for joy that a man is born into the world. And ye now, therefore, have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart shall rejoice, and your joy no man taketh from you. Here endeth the second lesson.
The Benedictus is found on page 14 of the Book of Common Prayer. Let's recite this canticle together. Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he hath visited and redeemed his people, and hath raised up a mighty salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spake by the mouth of his holy prophets, which have been since the world began, that we should be saved from our enemies, and from the hand of all that hate us, to perform the mercy promised to our forefathers, and to remember his holy covenant, to perform the oath which he sware to our forefather Abraham, that he would give us, that we, being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him, all the days of our life. And thou, child, shall be called prophet of Elias, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people for the remission of their sins, through the tender mercy of our God, whereby the day spring from on high hath visited us, to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide
our feet
into
the way of peace.
Glory
be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. O Lord, show thy mercy upon us,
and grant us thy salvation.
O God, make clean our hearts within us,
and take not thy Holy Spirit from us.
Almighty God, who showest to those who are in error the light of thy truth, to the intent that they may return into the way of righteousness, grant unto all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion, that they may avoid those things that are contrary to their profession, and to follow all such things as are agreeable to the same, through Jesus Christ our Lord. God, who art the author of peace and lover of comfort, and knowledge of whom standeth our eternal life, whose service is perfect freedom, defend us, thy humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in thy defense, may not fear the power of any adversaries, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
O Lord, our heavenly Father, almighty and everlasting God, who has safely brought us to the beginning of this day, defend us in the same but with thy mighty power, and grant that this day we fall into no sin, neither run into any kind of danger, but that all our doings being ordered by thy governance may be righteous in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
O most mighty and merciful God, in this time of grievous sickness, we flee unto thee for succor. Deliver us, we beseech thee, from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means made use for their cure. And grant that, perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts unto that heavenly wisdom which leadeth to eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty God, Heavenly Father, give us grace to trust thee alone during this time of illness and distress, and mercy put an end to the epidemic that affects us. Grant relief to those who suffer and comfort all the more. Sustain all those engaged in the ministry of medicine and healing and their labors, and cause thy people ever to serve you in righteousness and holiness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord God, we humbly confess to you that we deserve your fatherly chastisement for our sins. Yet we earnestly implore you, for thy name's sake, to spare us in this time of disaster. Restrain all harmful powers and help thy suffering people, that your word may be declared faithfully without hindrance, and that we, amending our sinful lives, may walk in safety and peace according to thy will and thy holy commandments, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Lord, our Heavenly Father, the high and mighty ruler of the universe, who thus from thy throne behold all the dwellers upon earth, most humbly we beseech thee with thy favor to behold and bless thy servant, Donald, the President of the United States, and all others in authority, and so replenish them with the grace of thy Holy Spirit, that they may always incline to thy will and walk in thy way, and do them plenteously with heavenly gifts, and grant them in health and prosperity long to live and finally after this life, to attain everlasting joy and felicity, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Staying together, almighty and everlasting God, from whom cometh every good and perfect gift, send out upon our bishops and the clergy and upon the congregations committed to their charge, the help and spirit by grace, and that they may truly please thee, pour upon them the continued view of thy blessing. Grant this, O Lord, for the honor of our advocate and mediator, Jesus Christ. Amen. Prayer for all conditions of men, now on page 18.
seasons to make thy ways on earth and in thy saving help unto all nations. More especially we pray for thy holy church universal, that it may be so guided and governed by thy good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth, and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. Finally, we commend to thy fatherly goodness all those who are in ways afflicted or distressed, in mind, body, or estate. And it may please thee to comfort and relieve them according to their several necessities, giving them patience under their sufferings, and a happy issue out of all their afflictions. And this we beg for Jesus Christ's sake.
Amen.
Praying together the general thanksgiving. Almighty God,
Father of all mercies, we thine unworthy servants,
give thee most humble thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men.
We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, and above all, thy merciful love and the redemption of the world
by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth thy praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service, and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
Almighty God, who hast given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplications unto thee, and thus promise that when two or three are gathered together in thy name, thou wilt grant their requests. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants, as may be most expedient for them, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come life everlasting. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with us all evermore. Amen.
Good morning. We welcome our parishioners and friends and visitors who might be worshiping with us this morning on this third Sunday after Easter. We continue to stream our services on Facebook. If you would like to know more about the Anglican Way of Christianity, please contact us either on Facebook or go to our webpage at stochouston.org. We would be happy to visit with you. As we begin to move towards the new normal, I'm very pleased to announce that beginning next Sunday, on May 10th, we will restore public worship here at St. Thomas of Canterbury. We have some distancing and other guidelines that will be going out in the next few days. There will be a seating plan, and our goal is to restore worship, but to keep everyone safe. So you can watch for that. Either membership will get an email, but we'll also be putting things on our Facebook page and homepage. Finally, we appreciate your prayers and your continued support. We continue to pray for all those that have been touched by the coronavirus, the illness in their families, or deaths. Every life is precious, and the pandemic is a reminder of how fragile, as one of our prayers said, our lives are. So please continue to pray for loved ones and friends as
Sunday after Easter, I would like us to consider idolatry, especially in light of the first portion of our Psalter, Psalm 115, our reading today, which says, "Not unto us, O Lord, not unto us, but unto thy name give praise, for thy loving mercy and for thy truth's sake. Wherefore the heathen shall say, where now is their God? As for our God, is he in heaven? He is in heaven. He hath done whatsoever pleaseth him. Their idols are silver and gold, even the work of men's hands. They have mouths and speak not. Eyes have they, and see not. They have ears and hear not. Noses have they, and smell not. They have hands and handle not. Feet have they, and walk not. Neither speak they through their throat. They that make them are like unto them, and so all such as put their trust in them." This is quite an indictment, summarized in the end by verse 17, "The dead praise not thee, O Lord, neither all they that go down into silence." Those who look to idols unto themselves and not unto the name of the Lord are dead. No gray here, no part way, no subtle distinctions, no fancy nuance. They are the dead. It's definitely something worth avoiding. Idolatry is a serious matter in all its forms. It violates the first commandment always, "Thou shalt have no other gods before me," and the second on graven images many times as well. John Calvin of the Reformation was quite concerned about idolatry, observing that the human heart is a factory for idols, commenting in his Institutes, in this quote, "So it goes. Man's mind, full as it is of pride and boldness, dares to imagine a God according to its own capacity as it sluggishly plods. Indeed, is overwhelmed with its crassest ignorance, it conceives an unreality, an empty appearance, as God. To these evils, a new wickedness joins itself, that man tries to express in his work the sort of God he has inwardly conceived. Therefore, the mind begets an idol. The hand gives it birth. The example of the Israelites shows the origin of idolatry to be that men do not believe God is with them unless he shows himself physically present. We know not, they said, what has become of this Moses. Make us gods who may go before us. They knew indeed that this was God whose power they experienced in very many miracles, but they did not trust he was near them unless they could discern with their eyes a physical symbol of his countenance, which for them would be a testimony of the ruling God. Therefore they wished to recognize from an image going before them that God was the leader of their march. Daily experience teaches that flesh is always uneasy until it has obtained some figment like itself in which it may fondly find solace as in the image of God. In almost every age since the beginning of the world, men, in order that they might allay this blind desire, set up symbols in which they believe God appeared before their bodily eyes." So says Calvin. This is what people do. We want things to relate to, so we use things that look like what we're familiar with. As Calvin said, "Flesh seeks some figment like itself in which it may fondly find solace as an image of God." In seeking an image like itself or like ourselves, we are repeating the Edenic pattern. We seek to find our own way to be like God or to become God, and somehow perceive these likenesses and our control over them to bring us closer to that end. But as the psalmist notes, our creations may have the ornaments of sense and expression, eyes, noses, ears, etc. But because we cannot give them life, our creations are dead. And in trying to make our own gods, we not only fail to bring them to life, we bring ourselves death. In our modernized Western culture, it would be easy to think this isn't much of a problem anymore. We don't generally go to our friends' houses and see shrines with household gods, at least not among our Christian friends. And yet, I would submit that idolatry is as big a problem today as it ever was. Just the form is altered. Let us take a physical example of modern culture, our smart TV. Your average smart TV is a gateway idol to many gods. in politics, entertainment, and even various forms of church. You did not make your smart TV, but it does have a camera. So in a sense, it does see. It has a microphone, so it does hear. It has a speaker, and so it speaks. And yet, there surely is a statue made of wood or stone. It has no life. And as with the idols of wood and stone, if you look for it, to it for your life, then you are as likely to be as dead as it is. Now I grant there is an exception here. One can be fed through the television to some extent by way of stream services that you cannot physically get to, due to some circumstance or infirmity, say, daily office through your browser like this, or a video course or a study series. Still, spiritual life exclusively as the body of Christ cannot be lived apart from the body of Christ. Man cannot live by television or computer alone. Parts of the body have to be attached to be alive. Showing them to each other on camera does not make a body whole. The overall point being that in our modern society, except for people who might worship money or their car or something that has substance like this, we don't see much of the physical idols that a person would have made in the past and would have been found in their house or in a place of worship, for the most part. Instead, as a culture with our somewhat sanitized cultural Christianity, what we have done is we've transferred our idolatry from the dead physicality of a stone or wood statue to the equally dead idolatry of ideas, institutions, celebrities, and authority figures. Think back for a moment on the thoughts of Calvin about idolatry as we look at some of the instances of how it plays out in the process. In politics, we see idolatry taking on full bloom with a continual search for the next Messiah. When someone is elected for one party, that person is generally seen as the new savior, who can do almost no wrong. For that party, for the other party, the same person is the devil, the idol or personification of evil, as it were. And you can already see here a setting up of an old Gnostic system of duality, where you have a struggle between the good deity and the bad deity. For those whose savior is in ascendancy, they seek to give more and more power or homage to that person or idol, and they will sacrifice more and more of themselves, maybe their freedoms. You can plug in whichever party you want, because our political system has, in regard to pattern, evolved into an interchangeable system of idolatry, as opposed to a principled system of representative government. And as Christians, we need to be aware of the theological realities that are forming around us, and find ways to participate in our government responsibly without sacrificing our faith to idolatry that is inherent in our system, something that is increasingly more and more difficult, but I believe still doable. In entertainment, we see actors portray characters. In a series, we become more and more familiar with the character and feel that familiarity with them. Sometimes it extends on to the actor themselves. In sports, it's much the same. We watch players. We see them in interviews. We root for their team. We cheer. We hoot. We holler. We feel a connection and a loyalty. And sometimes, idolization occurs as an outgrowth of fandom. It happens even in the church, with a favorite teacher, popular minister, or authority figure. It's saddest here, and we should all be most aware that all of us, every single one, is under authority, the one who sees all. But as Calvin pointed out, the making of idols is about fondly finding solace in that image of God. It's about feelings. For some, it's about feeling comfort. For others, it's about feeling control. Once things are based on feelings, once those become the frame of reference, all bets are off, because feelings are subjective. Mine are different from yours. And who is to say that yours are more or less valid than mine? Lacking a fixed reference skews all perspective. God does not call us to a lack of feeling, though, but he does call us to order them for him and subject them to his will. It's not always easy for us. We are engulfed in the tech and media of our day. The politics, the entertainment, all of it is in constant competition for our attention, and our affection, and by extension, to some degree, our worship. Much of it seems to demand that we feel a certain way about it. Would you like to assign emoticon to that? And it's designed to generate an emotional response. In that mix, we need to consider what a godly response is. We hear much during this crisis about the meaning of churches or not. Some say that Peter's letter and the letter to Romans demand that we always obey the government as God has ordained. Yet both of the apostles were jailed for disobeying the authorities. More to the point, both were killed for it. Were they then disobedient to the Holy Spirit that inspired those words? Or maybe we are mistaken in our interpretation. Do we make an idol of government? Those are valid questions. Yet we can also go to the opposite, can we not? We could oppose everything from a spirit of oneness and not from consideration, and end up worshiping an idol of rebelliousness and contention. Is our opposition truly godly? Or is it opposition just to be in opposition? These are valid questions as well. Idols to the left, idols to the right, idols lie in wait on either side of that road. Ideas can be idols too. The idea or idol of the rebel can easily become an idol. But then so can other ideals that might seem more noble. Peace and unity become idols, especially when we redefine them according to our terms and not the Lord's. This homily is short on detail on purpose this week, and that is by design. I actually spent a lot of time typing and then erasing, because our lives are varied, as are each of our personal encounters with idolatry. Each of the things I mentioned could easily take a whole Sunday school class to delve into, as well as the many I did not include or included and then erase. Man, maybe one day we'll book out a series on idolatry, I don't know. Either way, it was a far longer homily than anyone was going to want to hear. So I leave you with this, and as this virus situation winds down and other aspects of our lives open up, I would ask that you consider your own relationship with idolatry. Meditate on it. Take a deep look at life as it is, and as you would have it be. In this quiet time, it is a good time to put our idols aside in order to meet the world afresh. What are your idols? Do you have them? Do you know them? Have you considered them? Do not let it be said of you in the end, they that make them are like unto them, and so are all such as put their trust in them. But rather use this time to the deepening and betterment of your faith and to the health of your soul. So in closing, I today pray the calling for you and yours. Almighty God, who shows to those who are an heir of the light of the truth, to the intent that they may return into the way of righteousness, grant to all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion, that they may avoid those things that are contrary to their profession, and follow all such things that are agreeable to the same, through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Yeah, I thank you for being with us this morning. As I dismiss us with a blessing. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.